Sıkıntı yapıyorlar.
Sana mail geldi mi? Ben alamam.
Geldi ama buna gelmesin.
Ne yapalım? Sen almıyorsun.
Thank you.
So this is the outline. The talk will be divided into three parts. This part is the biggest, nano-electronic colloidal coating talks. And then there will be a two shorter part related to newly appeared quantum well structures based on colloidal technology. And a few words will be spoken about nano-electronics. So first part. Nano-optoelectronics with colloidal nanocrystal. Is it really possible? So this is a list of components which are anyway available either in research laboratories or in mines or in the market already maybe, or in industry as development. You see, and you can see, I will prove that this list actually exists. So you see, today we have optical filters, optical modulators, electro-optical modulators, luminophores, light-emitting diodes even appeared very lately, lasers, photodetectors, solar cells, and various sensors. So actually we can speak that colloidal nanocrystals can be considered as a base of certain fields of nanoelectronics. Let me start from the very beginning. Let me consider which basic properties of colloidal nanocrystals are important for optoelectronics. If you consider an evolution of matter, stepwise evolution of matter from a single atom to solids, you can find two distinct steps. First, this is clusters consisting of certainly definitely organized finite number of atoms. And then there is another very important step, which we call nanocrystal. This is a few period of crystal lattice, which serves as a quantum box for electronics and for waves, viewed as the context of their wave function. And in this range, where we have from 2,000 to maybe 100,000 atoms, all electronic and optical properties appear to be size dependent. I would mention that every time you have change in the electronic properties, you have immediately change in optical properties, since optics operate with electrons. Optics operate with electrons in the outer shells of atoms forming solid body or making chemical bonds in molecules. So optics is actually electronics in essence. So these are quantum box for electrons and holes, and they have size-dependent optical and electronic properties. So this is a small video like you see cartoon. As you can imagine, you have a quantum particle with the Bohr wavelength, and you can consider this particle feels comfortable inside a potential box, and also particle with another wavelength feel comfortable. And this is just this nanocrystal shown here, on a real scale, you see, that serves as a quantum box for these wave-like entities, electrons and holes. And for this reason, semiconductor nanocrystals acquire a notation of quantum dot. But note that this is not the case for metal nanocrystals. In metal nanocrystals, the Bohr wavelength is approximately the same as period of lattice. And you cannot confine electron in metals. Fortunately or unfortunately. What else? So, because of this quantum box properties, you see, instead of valence band, continuous valence band, and conduction band, we have now discrete level for holes and for electrons. And instead of multiple optical transition, which forms well-known absorption edge behavior in semiconductors for photon energy higher than band gap energy, you have now a selected number of discrete transition, which forms absorption band. And this, you see, position of these levels can be estimated using very simple textbook quantum mechanical formula, which first was proposed by Efes and Efferson this year, and then corrected by Bruce 2 years later. That means this is a sum of kinetic energies of holes here and electron here. And this is correction factor because electron and hole are coincide in space, so they have to interact Coulombically. And this is Coulombic interaction which make energy a little bit lower. So these are three people who actually founded the field which I'm talking about. So these are Russian experimental scientist Alexey Yekimov, Russian experimental theoretical scientist Alexander Efres, and American physical chemist Louis Bruce. I know all of them personally for many years, and I was lucky to visit this library every Monday to watch new journal, and I observed these journals immediately when this paper appeared. So I'm a witness of this new field. You see. At that time, I was second year PhD student, and I put this idea already in my PhD thesis. You see, we speak about citation numbers. You see, this Journal of Chemical Physics has input factor something like 3 to 4. And you see the paper from this journal. If this is pioneering paper, it was cited 4,000 times. It's semiconductor, this is a Russian journal, Soviet journal, which is called Physics and Technology of Semiconductors, to translate it into English. It has input factor called 0.6. And you see 2,000 citations. So you need to be a pioneer to get high citation number independent, and this number will not depend on input factor. Then you'll make input factor with themselves, okay? So this is what this consideration predicts. You can take different semiconductors, you see. These semiconductors have different absorption age defined by the band gap. This is electron volt energy for these band gaps, and this is wavelength corresponds to the absorption onset. Then you go to smaller crystallite size. According to this formula, you have change. You see, you have blue shift to the blue of absorption age. And then starting from absolutely black materials like cadmium selenide and cadmium telluride in black, look like a piece of coal. A piece of coal. They are absolutely black and like polished piano, surface of polished piano, you see, because of high refractive index, but absolutely black. Then you go to nanocrystalline, they shine like diamonds, like pigments, you see. And this actually happens. This actually, amazingly, this actually happens. This is, you see here, this is a place where solid state physics matches with quantum chemistry and with chemistry itself, and also with molecular science itself. You see, this is, if you consider from cluster, from crystal to nanocrystal, you should apply this formula and you can plot a curve like this. But you see, experimental scientists found very carefully that there is some deviation. So we can speak that, you see, amazing. Until 3 nanometer, you see, radius, this is 6 periods of lattice. Solid state physics, this particle in a box problem predicts. This is very, very primitive problem. You can imagine, very, no finite barrier included. No dielectric environment included, you see. Very, very, very primitive. It works till here. And then predicts the reasonable trend. So this discrepancy can be overtaken by means of another way from cluster to crystal. This is quantum chemistry. So people collect atoms together and then calculate their properties. It is possible to make the same curve starting from very small clusters and then by means of it increasing the number of atoms in clusters, you see. And this is again this curve from solid state physics like this. You see the same situation. You see that quantum chemistry gives probably better, you see, it predicts better behavior here, more accurate. But you see, again, this is, you see, very, very nice coincidence that until you see a few nanometers, solid state physics and this quantum confinement phenomena don't do works. Amazing. This was one of the most exciting theoretical output which I feel myself when I was involved. Here, different points correspond to different groups, and red points correspond to group from our institute. This is from 1995. So, in 90s, in that period, people were worried about this level structures, you see, optical transition probability, you see, to find narrowband emission and to find narrowband absorption. And at least three people I know made habilitation thesis. This is Ladislav Banya, this is Ulrika Bergen, and this is myself. And we all three of us published at that time, in the same decade. So this is theoretical, and this book experimental. This is a book which Wolfgang already mentioned. It was translated later on into Chinese. But as we say, new time, new songs. So I'm here not because of this book. In spite of how many times Wolfgang repeat it, you say, I'm here because of these modern trends. As we say, new song, the new time, new songs. You see, new trends appear, and we speak now about solar cells, you see, about optoelectronics, photovoltaics, you see, and there are a new generation of researchers. Andrei Rogoch is a young researcher, younger than me, okay? I'm already, sorry. He's mature, but still much younger than me. That means, you see, this is a summary of chemical opportunities to make colloidal nanocrystals. And Viktor Klimov is shaping the field related to lasers. I will show their photos. You see, recent titles. You see, this is our, you see, introductory paper, colloidal nanophotonics imaging platforms. Emergence of colloidal light emitting technology. You see, light emitting diets based on quantum. solar cell. You see what's going on? Very active field, and this field seems to be 100% applied. Nobody speaks about exciton-exciton interaction of many particle states confined in the same quantum box as we spoke 20 years ago, and we are proud to have this attitude to this complicated quantum mechanical problems. Now people speak about very practical things, you see, and use very smart ideas how to get there. You see, let me just briefly mention the basic components. So optical filters are known as nanocrystals in glasses for many decades. And I also studied it. This is a Soviet Union type of couple filters. We measured the mean size, and you see that this mean size remarkably correlates, you see, with size-dependent absorption age. You see, and also there are some certain manifestation of optical transition band related to discrete optical transition, you see. So what about optical modulators? Optical modulators are known for many decades as well. These are first hints. You see, because of this discrete transition, semiconductor nanocrystals show very well pronounced optical absorption saturation, like molecular and atomic system. If you pump hard quantum dot system, you will saturate optical transition when average number of electron hole pairs you create by photons per dot will be equal to 1. When every quantum dot will contain 1 excited electron hole pairs, absorption coefficient will go to zero. This is called absorption saturation. If you have molecular ensemble, if you excite all molecules to the upper state, then population of upper state will be exactly equal to the population of ground state. All upward transitions stimulated by input radiation will be compensated by all downward transition, and absorption coefficient will be zero. This is called absorption saturation. How it looks like? If you consider optical density, 3 means that only 1,000 part of incident light coming through. Then if you increase in density, then you will have bleaching up to zero. Density zero means transmission is 100%. This is called optical absorption saturation, and this is used to get nanosecond and picosecond pulses in lasers. If such saturable absorber is inserted in a cavity of solid state laser, then you arrive to the regime which is called mode locking, and in this mode locking regime you can arrive at picosecond pulses, and this is wavelength, this is materials, solid state active laser materials, wavelength, and duration of pulses which were obtained in our Belarusian National Technical University using lead-sulfur nanocrystals in glasses as laser modulator. In other regime, you perform Q-switching of a cavity. In this case, you arrive at nanosecond pulses. And this is, again, the same material. This is the same group and the same material. You see lead-selenide nanocrystals in glasses used for Q-switching to get nanosecond pulses in different, you see, in near infrared. So, what about electro-optical modulators? Not so easy. Electro-optical effect does exist. And you see here absorption spectra of quantum dots from our common paper, by the way, with Volkan Demir, in the same magazine you see where paper by Efros and Efros was cited 2000 times. You haven't got such a citation, unfortunately. You see, if you increase voltage, you see, voltage seems to be big, but this is actually volts, 10 to 20 volts, because we use thin film. You see, you can completely vanish the absorption band here. You see, the absorption smear. It is good for dots, not so pronounced for elongated nanoparticles, which we call nanorods. You see, but the problem is that you have, we cannot arrive immediately at fast modulation. Not only absorption, but also photoluminescence can be modulated. Again, we compare here dots versus rods. You see, when we apply voltage, then luminescence quench. You see here, something like 20 times from here to there, something like 20 times. But as I mentioned, okay, we can go to another materials, go from the visible to infrared, and by using, I already mentioned the lead sulfur. You see, by using lead sulfur, when applying electric field, you you can get absorption modulation in the wavelength which is used for commercial optical communication, you see. But further studies are necessary in this case, since optics interplay of photo-induced and electro-induced phenomena in quantum dots, you see, do not promise us immediately reproducible fast recovery of the optical absorption after you switch off electric field. And in this case, nanoplatelets looks much more promising than quantum dots because nanoplatelets are macroscopically big. So this charging effects should not be charging and neutralization effects should not be so pronounced in bigger nanoplatelets as compared to the quantum dots. Lumina force, including discrete devices and bioplates. If you consider what nanocrystals can bring as compared to the non-luminescent materials, this is, first of all, very convenient controllable spectral range. Very narrow band emission spectrum, wide band excitation spectrum, important for many applications. High stability, doping options, and option for electroluminescence operation. If you consider, for example, rare earths, they do not have wide band excitation. They have very narrow excitation, you see. If you consider rare earths, for rare earths electroluminescence is not possible. Straightforward, you see. And so on, so forth. So, again, I remind you this basic figure, you see, and this is the number of emission spectrum from cadmium to the right absolutely black material with absorption in infrared, but then it's going to the visible, nearing to the blue, you see, when getting nanocrystalline, and this data are provided by our common colleague, Nikolai Kapunin, which left Minsk for Dresden a couple decades ago, and now is full professor at Technical University of Dresden. So, for lumina force, core shell ideology was important. It was coined by well-known professor Mungi Baveti from MIT. He is actually the leader in development of lumina force based on semiconductor nanocrystals today. And the idea is the following, that we need a core covered by a shell to get well-defined potential well. If we do not organize well-defined potential well, then surface structure will be beyond our control. And surface recombination traps will kill our luminescence. And quantum yield will be unpredictable and uncontrollable. And luminophore will be unstable. So this core shell ideology was very important. At that time, in the 90s, at that time, Andrei Rogosh, I already mentioned, was working also in the same field, you see, and this is photos which he provided me approximately 20 years ago when I was making a talk at some conferences. Based on cadmium telluride here, you can see you can see the substances here also. So, but the situation is not so easy. You see, quantum confinement gives rise to size-dependent properties, but quantum confinement always confines carriers. And as I mentioned, you see, you can create electron-hole pairs confined in quantum dots, and you should characterize your ensemble by average number of quantum dots, quantum electron-hole pairs per dot. But anyway, at any level of excitation, even at very low average number of electron-hole pairs per dot, certain dots can gain more than one electron-hole pair. This is called Poissonian statistic. Poissonian statistic characterized by discrete distribution, and that means that even if you have the average number of electron-hole pairs small, the different dots possess different number of electron-hole pairs. And in case there are more than one electron-hole pair confined within the same dot, then intense Auger recombination occurs. Did you know what is Auger recombination? That means that electron and hole recombine, but instead of emitting photon, this energy is captured by another electron, which goes to upper state. And for this reason, first of all, it is necessary that three particles should be in the same place. Two particles recombine, the third particle carries energy. But in case of bulk semiconductors, there is also momentum conservation and energy conservation. So this is energy versus momentum for a conductance band and for a valence band. And imagine you have here an electron which wants to recombine with hole. The electron sees for a possible hole here, and the electron can recombine with the hole radiatively if momentum is the same, like this. But if there is another electron which can carry energy and momentum like this, then electron can recombine with this hole. And for this very tight condition, you see, Auger recombination is less probable in the bulk. But this picture, you see, disappears when we go to quantum dot. In quantum dot, there is no quasi-momentum conservation law anymore. And then Auger recombination becomes very, 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 very drastically enhanced. And it was necessary to come with very ingenious idea that also Alexander Efrost contributed a lot to this, that instead of rectangular barrier, we need smooth barrier. And this smooth barrier modifies overlapping of electron-hole wave function. And then under this condition, they show it will be possible to cancel, to inhibit this multiparticle process. And it is owing to this, this progress, to this idea, and to experimental implementation of this idea, that you see, when I come to Ankara, first what I saw, this is an announcement of quantum dot TV set. This was taken yesterday, you see, from the net, you see, Samsung used quantum dots in display already. I believe this is this is exactly owing to this successful solution of the problem of Auger recombination. There was certain aphoria that you see, even silicon nanocrystals shine. And there was aphoria that probably silicon becomes direct gap material and we can arrive at first silicon laser. We even organized conference. At that time spent some money from NATO for peace program, you see, but silicon laser did not appear. Probably sponsorship was not enough for this. But probably this is still physics. Silicon still appear to be indirect gap material. And by the way, it shines because of the statistical Poissonian distribution of trap states. There are some nanocrystals which simply have no defects. And this crystal shines. But it doesn't mean that we can make good luminophores and or we can make a laser of this. It is possible to dope luminophore to get, you see, different separate engineering of excitation spectrum and emission spectrum. This is an example of manganese doped nanocrystals, and we suggest that this is important to enhance sensitivity of silicon detector in the near UV. This is an example how it is possible to enhance by means of energy conversion from the blue to the red where sensitivity is high. So lighting sources. Obsolete incandescent lamp use hot body radiation. This is hot body radiation at different temperatures, and this temperature approximately corresponds to sunlight, and you see under this temperature most of the radiation goes into the visible. But this is the range where we actually can heat, filaments in incandescent lamp. This is no more than 3000 Kelvin. And under this condition, you see most of the radiation goes into the infrared. So efficiency is very low. Efficiency can become higher by using compact fluorescent lamp. But you see compact fluorescent lamp exhibits spectrum which is absolutely different as compared to the sun spectrum. So it is not friendly. It consists of, you see, discrete line, whereas you see the sunlight looks like black body radiation at temperature about 6000 Kelvin. White lens looks much better, though still not like sun, but much better than the compact fluorescent lamp. And I would mention that white lens consists of a blue lens and luminophore. Adding luminophore emission to the blue gives you the vision of white light. And there is a certain problem. How can we develop good luminophore to have the proper, you see, color rendering index, to have friendly light, you see, not like this, but maybe more like this. And you see, this is an example of what you are doing here, you see. I'm very happy to show you. Yes, you know this, and so let me stop at this. So this is what Professor Wolken doing with his colleagues. This is an example how colloidal quantum dots can be used to make you see very nice lumina for which possess very high color vision parameters, color vision parameters. Colloidal LEDs. Let me say it is colloidal LED invention which make me sure that we are near the colloidal optoelectronics paradigm. Because what I showed before, it's only optical components. But LED is already optoelectronic. Okay, so this again example from Ankara, you see. So this is fully colloidal system, multi-layer without epitaxy. Modern LEDs are based on epitaxy in high vacuum, mainly MOCVD techniques. You see, and this is absolutely alternative technique. This is colloidal approach which looks more like we are making coffee maybe, or our wives making soups, you see, or salads, you see, something like this, or juices, you see, like this, in my mind. So nothing related to very high vacuum and so on and so forth. No expensive monocrystalline substrates, you see, and so on. So there are a few active groups. Viktor Klimov at Los Alamos, this is Reinke. You see, and also there is a message from Chinese group. They reported they arrived at nearly 20% external efficiency or overall efficiency. You see, 20% overall efficiency is very, very sound. You see, in the red is absolutely, you see, polymer based multi-layer structure without MOCVD or any technology. Now lasers. We have already quantum dot lasers. Still with optical pumping. So the story dates back to this year when Arakawa predicted that zero-dimensional semiconductor laser, which is quantum dot like, considered like zero-dimensional because electrons confined in all dimensions, should have temperature-independent threshold. Temperature dependence of threshold is a disaster for semiconductor lasers. And because the laser is heating, then threshold going up. And if the threshold is going up with temperature, you need to pump harder. And then you pump harder, you produce more heat, and so on and so forth. So finally, diode cannot operate. And this was one of the papers. This paper should be added to that what I showed you, the same year, you see, 1982. Then people think a lot about quantum dots and how to make them. You see, first observation of optical gate was made by Viktor Klimov. At that time, he was working in Moscow University. 1991, but at 77 Kelvin only, and he did not report on reliable laser. He just reported he saw gain and laser. You see, and now this is very high activity of quantum dot heterostructure. This is heteroepitaxial quantum dots, and there are even books written about quantum dot lasers based on strained heterostructure, heterepitaxial heterostructure. They are electrically pumped, but we are speaking about colloidal technologies, okay? So in colloidals we have lasers, but till now they are optically pumped. And they are based actually on Klimov's idea. So it is not a problem, it is not a big deal to get optical gain in theory. In theory, if you have one electron hole pair per dot, you have absorption saturation. If you have second electron hole pair per dot, you have optical gain. This is very simple. But it is observed, it is predicted in theory, this is absorption edge, and this is what's going on with if you pump over there. You pump over there, so you change, you see, absorption here, and sometimes absorption under high excitation, sometimes absorption goes to negative, that means you have optical gain. And this is experimental, it's experimental observed. But again, two electron hole pairs in the same box, Auger process. Intensive Auger processes, and then laser is not, you see, reasonable. Laser vanishes immediately, because of the same problem. So if you create two electron hole pairs, you cannot get immediate stable laser from them because of this, you see, competitive Auger processes, which serve as efficient bypass, you see, preventing radiative recombination of electron hole pair within the dot. So Viktor Klimov come up with suggestion that instead of this type of dots where you have at the same time quantum well for electrons and quantum wells for hole, we should arrive at another type 2 quantum dots where you have a quantum well for electrons, but there is no quantum well for holes. For holes, as you say, energy counts here. So here, this is a well for holes, and this is not well. To make structure like this, you should take into account the absolute value of ionization potential, or as we say, WEC. I don't know the English equivalent. Energy you need to for electron to take from the crystal to vacuum. So you must compare absolute energy of electrons and holes in crystals with vacuum energy. And then you see which materials you can combine to get either this type of quantum dots or this type of quantum dots. And what was his idea? His idea was as follows, that if we have a system like this, then electron-hole wave function do not overlap so much. And since they do not overlap so much, they produce local electric field. And as I showed you, local electric fields do change absorption. Do change absorption. And local electric fields change the energy of electron-hole transition. And because of this changing of electron-hole energy transition, single electron-hole pair, while recombining, produce photons which has not been observed, which has not been absorbed. That means you have a kind of free-level structure, an analog of free-level system, that you have the fed level appeared after optical transition occurred. And in this case, Klimov predicted it will be possible to get optical gain with a single electron. And he called it single exciton optical gain semiconductor on a crystal. And he succeeded to get it, actually. He succeeded to get it. And now he has, you see, already followers. You see the other group comes in and follows, and you see different colors of lasers now available, and all of them are based on colloidal quantum dot fields, not on crystals. Quantum dot solids and photodetectors. You see Monkey Bagetti, which I already cited, coined a very nice idea. He suggested that we can make colloidal crystals based on quantum dots. He called it quantum dot solid. Very ingenious idea, very nice. This is a photo taken from Science in 1996. When I was writing my book, you see, this paper just appeared. I was already about submitting the book to Cambridge. And at that time, we have no good copy machine, you see, and magazines, photo in magazines were of very poor quality. I sent hard copy letter to him asking to provide a photo, and he provided photo. And I included photo already in my book issue. Was cited, you see, at that time immediately, because I understand that without these photos, the book will not be interesting. So this was a very nice idea, quantum dot solid, new type of solid. In this case, you see, you can find each, in every dot you can find the electron hole, and then you put all things together. But, unfortunately, Bagetti failed to observe any change in absorption spectrum. They only observe energy transfer. Energy transfer phenomena. So you see, luminescence decay was changed, but absorption spectrum didn't. So we were challenged by this, and I consider that there should be, if you come from single quantum dots, from single quantum well, to ensemble of closed packed wells, then you see electron wave function should go delocalized, you see, in case of dense quantum dot ensembles. And you must arrive at a serious change in absorption spectrum. And we understand what happens. Bagetti used big dots, and we used smaller dots. So we use smaller dots, and we use diluted, concentrated, and condensed ensembles, you see. And what we get is here, this is our publication in 1999. So at first you have sharp optical transition, then this band concentration goes high, you see, it's smeared, and finally you arrive as if it was absorption onset in bulk semiconductors. But we are working with cadmium selenide. Cadmium selenide absolutely black. Absorption start with 700 nanometers. And here you see we have absorption at around 500. So we have new type of solid particles. We control optical properties by means of double level, you see, arrangement. first confinement inside dot and then arrangement of dot together. This is our modeling how it works. Then we include the volume fraction of quantum dots, provided that the size of quantum dots is pretty small. Then the number of the localized states rises up to 100%. And we also have successor. This is Belarusian colleague who graduated from our university in Minsk, then go for PhD course to Hamburg, to Hamburg or to Bremen, to Germany, working with Horst Weller, German professor. And so he believed it is possible to use this effect to make a phototransistor. And this is paper. He has also read you on these topics. You see, he observed high photoconductivity, you see, controllable by illumination, and this is considered now as a way to make photodetectors. Regretfully, I did not contribute anything to solar cells in my life. You see, I only show you the titles, you see, and you believe that colloidal quantum dots are used in solar cells, at least in laboratories. So, sensors. These two colleagues in the same issue of Science magazine published the idea that it is possible to consider that luminescent nanocrystals can be used to label molecules. Shamu Ni suggested first that it is very important that you can organize chemical bonding of quantum dot with proteins. And Paul Alibi Sartas evaluated the photostability of quantum dots, and he found that photostability is much more higher than photostability of typical, you see, this is fluorescein, well-known, well-defined, highly efficient molecule used for labeling in biophysics, in bioscience, and in immunoassay analysis. You see, we have also activity now in Russian Belarus, these names, Yusinabiev and Artemyev. But these people were pioneers. So then we have now the notion of bioconjugates. This is quantum dots chemically bonded to biomolecules. And you see this bioconjugates brings a new flavor to all this field. You see, this is, if you romantic enough, you will understand what I mean. You see, we provide chemical bonding between a piece of semiconductor. Piece of semiconductor, just a piece of microelectronic microchip, yes, with living organisms, with living creatures. So this is a way to combine electronics with living world, you see. And here I would make a very short stop and tell that, you see, we are always challenged by the, you see, mass media. What will be the immediate or fast social effect of your science and so on and so forth. So, and typically, I advise avoid answer to this question, because neither scientist knows what will be the basic, or like some Americans say, what will be the killer application. I can give you some example. What is the most popular application of lasers now? What do you think? I believe this is laser printers and UV plates. But when first lasers were designed, nobody think about laser printers or DVD players. People think about material processing, about killing each other, you see, maybe about surgery, but not about DVD players. Another example, what about computers? I remember I used computer which occupied a place like this. You see, there was a team near 10 people around it, you see. Nobody believed there will be the time that computer will be, you see, a personal image-making gadget of junior school. But this is what we have. That means nobody knows what will be the main social impact of nanotechnology. But we can guess that there should be something which did not exist. Phototransistors, you see, light emitting diodes, you see, lasers, computers. This is already existing, well-defined entities. Okay? Let's think about what is hidden in nanotechnology, which do not exist. And maybe here we can expect something which do not exist, and we do not know the way to level. This is something like an interface between electronics and biology, in a very complicated manner. So this is, I would like to mention by the general notion of sensors, okay? Because I do not know actually. So I finished with nanocrystalline quantum dots, and now this is the second part, this is nanoplatelets. Nanoplatelets is very recent, very new analog, colloidal analog of semiconductor quantum well epitaxial structures. Semiconductor quantum well epitaxial structures actually dates back to the ideas of double hetero structure by these two Nobel Prize winners, Kramer and Alfiorov. And Holonyak was the first to introduce quantum well structure in lasers. Nowadays, all semiconductor diodes and semiconductor lasers are essentially based on quantum well structures. So this is a real photo of quantum well. This is how it looks like. Hopefully, since you are nano people, so you know what is quantum well and nanotechnology. And I only want to mention that even blue LED, blue light emitting diodes, and these are Nobel Prize winners for this, also based on quantum well, and it was shown in the very first paper by Nakamura in 1995 that quantum well provide brighter light and much narrower emission spectrum as conventional double hetero structure does. So quantum wells are very important, shaping semiconductor lasers and semiconductor LED technology today. And the basic effect in quantum wells is because of the confinement in one dimension, you have enhanced exciton binding energy, and you have another optical transition as compared to the bulk. This is very old. David Miller-Potter, who was, by the way, supervisor of Hilmer Wolf Engineer at UR and PhD course in Stanford, and dated back to 1985. You see, this is what's going on. We confine electron in the well, and theory predicts that exciton binding energy, exciton, this is electron hole coupled by Coulombic interaction, exciton binding energy should be enhanced by the factor of 4 in entirely two-dimensional system. But if you make the well thinner, then the energy comes higher and higher, and the electron feels the height of potential barrier. You cannot suggest the unfinite potential barrier in real heterostructure. And then you see that you depart from this, target of fourfold enhancement of exciton binding energy, and instead you have much lower. And now people arrive with colloidal quantum dots. This is with colloidal quantum wells. This is again a picture from Wilkent University. These are quantum platelets. This is what it is, just few monolayers, you see. This is absorption spectrum, you see sharp peaks, exciton peaks, and this is emission, very narrow, very nice emission spectrum. What's going here? Electron and hole in nanoplatelets interact Coulombically both through very thin layer, quasi-two-dimensional layer, but mainly through the surrounding medium. And surrounding medium is not a semiconductor, like an epitaxial heterostructure. It is polymer or air or solution. And there is, we have the electric permittivity much higher than inside. And higher the electric permittivity means stronger electron hole, stronger Coulomb coupling. And you have numerous, multiple enhancements, you see, enhancement of binding energy, much more bigger than predicted by simple dimensional theory. And this gives us the hope that this structure might be even more promising for light emitting device that existing epitaxially based LEDs. Again, picture from your laboratory, you see, this is called fully colloidal quantum well laser. This is colloidal analog of quantum well laser. As I mentioned, most of current semiconductor lasers are based on epitaxial quantum well. Based on quantum well, made epitaxially. And this is colloidal analog of quantum well. You see, this is signature of laser, and this is another signature of laser sharp threshold behavior in light intensity. So we studied electric field effect on colloidal nanostructure of different topology, nanorods, quantum dots, and nanoplatelets, and we found that nanoplatelets are very promising, looks very promising for electro-optical effect. You see, at the same scale, in this row, you see nanoplatelets shows higher response to electric fields as compared to nanorods or as compared to quantum dots. And we hope that because of macroscopically large scale, nanoplatelets help us to avoid charging issues. Which here and in Mountain Dose. So just a few words about, maybe 3-4 minutes, a few words about colloidal nanoplasmonics. Nanoplasmonics also very old field, also very big field, but since we speak about colloidal nanoparticles, I will give you a few examples related to colloidal nanoparticles. Nanoplasmonics, in essence, this is enhancement of light matter interaction with metal nanostructures. Metal nanostructures enhance light matter interaction of any entities which adsorb on metal nanotextured surface. And how can it help? Actually, near nanobodies we have local enhancement of incident electric field of electromagnetic waves, sometimes few orders of magnitude. We have enhancement of decay rate probabilities for radiative spontaneous decay of excited atoms, molecules, or quantum dots, or quantum wells. And we have also, unfortunately, enhancement of non-radiative energy transfer from excited quantum system to metal nanoparticles. Metal nanoparticles gets warmer after that, but we lose excitation energy. We cannot get photons out of excited matter. And this combination, under certain condition, has a favorable output. In spite of the local field intensity factor good, radiative decay factor is good, but non-radiative decay is bad. But sometimes we have positive combination of these three factors, and then we can prove experimentally that we can enhance photoluminescence intensity, we can very drastically enhance Raman scattering intensity, which is important for sensor. We can enhance, probably, this theory and some first experiments, we can probably be able to enhance internal quantum efficiency of light-emitting diodes. And we expect to enhance lead modulation rate without losses in overall efficiency. This is a sketch how it works, for example, with molecular luminescence. We can put molecules with certain spacer on top of silver nanoparticles like this, and you can see that this portion looks much, emits like much brighter than the reference portion. You see, approximately one order of the magnitude is feasible for good emitters, and many orders of the magnitude are feasible for bad emitters. If emitter have very low quantum yield, we can enhance its intensity by several orders of the magnitude. If emitter has quantum yield close to 1, we can enhance by approximately the factor of 10, maybe 12, maybe 5, maybe 15, but not 100. So this is our predictions for internal quantum efficiency enhancement for LEDs. So this is emission wavelength here, and we suppose that quantum yield, internal quantum yield, intrinsic quantum yield is 0.95, so emitter should not be perfect to be enhanced in this case. And this is spacing between metal nanoparticle, silver nanoparticle, we take silver nanoparticle, and emitting layer. You can see that, for example, silver nanoparticle with diameter 80 nanometers, can enhance in this area, can enhance internal efficiency by the factor of from 2 to 3. Not 100, not 1,000, but a few times. It is also important that we can, at the same time, we can enhance photoluminescence of phosphor, which used to convert blue light into the white light. You see, and in this case we have much more flexibility. So here we can arrive with 50 nanometer, you see, particles with excitation wavelength corresponding to commercial blue LED. We can arrive nearly to 50, 60, 70 times in the very wide spectral range, provided we keep on, you see, spacing between like 3 and 10 nanometers. Spacing can be controlled by means of polyelectrolyte, or by means of atomic layer deposition, or by means of the logic techniques, maybe by vacuum deposition of some oxides, you see. And we can also enhance modulation rate for LEDs. Here we show that this is spectrum, this is enhancement of the overall rate predicted in our model. So we predict, you see, nearly 50 time enhancement for the blue LEDs, and something like 15 time enhancement for phosphor area. At the same time, as I mentioned, we can expect enhancement by tens times, you see, for intensity of phosphor. And under this condition, we still keep non-radiating decay, you see, to be very small as compared to full, to overall decay. That means we have no losses in external internal efficiency. So we gain in modulation rate, in the decay rate, by in intensity as well, you see, for phosphor, but we have no losses in internal efficiency. Why do we need to enhance the modulation rate of lead? There is a concept of LiFi. LiFi stands for light fidelity. Light fidelity, and it implies that when all this, you see, luminescent or incandescent lamps, you see, on top will be replaced by light emitting diode based systems, it is possible to modulate light. Yes? And this modulation can carry useful signal. This signal can be used to communicate. To communicate instead of Wi-Fi. What are you see, advantages? First advantage, no radio noise, no crosstalks, no permission to use radio frequency range, you see. Second, very big area frequency. Light frequency is several orders of the magnitude bigger than radio frequency, than radio range frequency. Okay? So you can put more data inside. And you see, no crosstalk with electronic device. People speak it will be even possible to use, you see, networking inside the airplane. And take it off. See. But we need fast rate. For this, we need fast rate. You see, this idea was launched by a Japanese group, you see, many years ago. And it was Harald Haas, I don't know why his name disappeared. He coined the very notation, Li-Fi, the very notation. He even published a book in Cambridge University about Li-Fi perspective for our life. So we believe it might be fast modulation rate enhanced by metal nanoparticles can be useful in the context of Li-Fi application. Also, plasmonics is important for sensors. This is just an example from our paper how this is semiconductor quantum dot Raman scattering can be enhanced. You see, signal comes from nothing. Can be enhanced many orders of the magnitude, can be enhanced by metal nanoparticles. And we suggested quantum dots to be Raman markers to substitute fluorescent markers in biological studies and in biological analysis. So I come to the conclusion, nearly 1 hour, you see, I come to the conclusion that colloidal nanoelectronics is possibly an emerging technology platform. Possibly an emerging technology platform. And I have a sketch, you see, this table, what we have at the moment. So this is components. And this is their status, and this is which type of semiconductor or metal colloidal nanocomponents can be used for implementation of these components. As you see, at first we have commercial filters, and we have first commercial application of Lumina 4 for display device. We have active research for many, you see, for many other applications, which may be, you see, upgraded to first commercial application. Maybe. Thank you for your attention. Volcan is a pioneer in colloidal quantum lasers. This is no doubt. I'm not ready. You see, I'm excited with the results I read. You see, and at the moment I don't know. But I can speculate the same as you see. You demonstrate in illumination that much higher excitant fighting energy than lower temperature sensitivity. Lower temperature. Since we believe that optical properties comes from excitant annihilation, then we should keep excitant features as high temperatures as possible. You see. So maybe it will be more reliable. Like maybe with standard platelets we will not need any more quantum dot platelets. Till now first quantum dot laser based on heterodetector was demonstrated somewhat like 20 years ago, is it correct?
Yes, but yes. It is now commercialized to electrically driven attacks.
Yes, it is commercialized, but not so many companies and not so many wavelengths. I saw the statistics that there might be just one or two companies which offer quantum dot lasers for 1.3 micron.
Right.
Not for DVD, not for Blu-ray, not for...
with major volume and commercial lasers.
Yes, quantum dot lasers.
We have other questions.
For multi-personal applications, we have mentioned all indicators for many of our partners. Mm-hmm. And now the semiconductors are also rising with the tunable damping properties. How do you see their future?
For plasmonics,
yes.
To get plasmonic phenomena, you need to very high concentration of electrons. Otherwise, the harmonic phenomena go to infrared and to radio frequency.
There are some papers with the carbon 7-8 and carbon sulfide holes as carriers.
I can imagine that you can exhibit plasmonic features, but not so pronounced as metal. Maybe I'm missing something, but as far as I understand, plasmonic effects are continuous in wavelengths, but if you have lower concentration of electrons, then the main effects goes to very long wavelengths, to very low frequencies. This frequency is proportional to the concentration, to the number of charges. I can give immediate example, ion sphere in atmosphere, that the upper layer of atmosphere consists of ions. And because of plasmonic property of these ions, it is possible to get far distance radio communication using short waves. In short waves, it looks like metal. Okay? In short waves. And this was the case in radio meteors 100 years ago. You see, overtook the commercial achievements in far-reaching radio communication. Because people's designers suggested that to avoid the curvature of Earth, we need a longer wavelength. And for longer wavelength, you need a giga antenna, you see, and generally emission power of an emitter is proportional to the frequency, probably in fourth degree or something like this. At least in second degree, or maybe higher, you see. So when you go to lower frequency, you should increase to amplitude of oscillation to get the same power. So, and then a meteor people with small radio stations becomes here at each other. And this was the effect of plasmonic. So plasmonic effects everywhere. But depending on concentration of charges, you should have availability of effects in certain frequency range. This is my feeling.
There was a question.
Many thanks for this presentation. I would like to ask one question about mode locking operation or the device for the mode locking. Mm-hmm. When we look the result, the people generate picosecond, not the femtosecond. Could you also comment the relaxation time of these quantum dots? Because it's the longer relaxation time than
okay.
Quantum dots.
Okay. I can cite a review by Rafailov a few years ago. Edward Rafailov, back in England, about ultrashort pulses with quantum dot as mode locus. And there are many tricks. You see, it is easy, it is readily to get picosecond pulses is a combination of saturable absorber decay and active area decay. But femtosecond pulses typically are obtained with some fuzzy tricks. And I do not aware if there are messages that direct to remote locking regime gives you immediate to the femtosecond pulses. Typically people use like a squeezing. First, this is an issue of wide spectrum of optical gain. Yes, to get short pulses, you need wide optical gain. And for this optical gain, you need mode locking. You see, so this is not so easy. I would say that my knowledge is that people first obtain picosecond pulses and then adjust some devices to make temporal squeezing. Shrinkage in time of these pulses. But maybe if you go to Rafailov or just put the name in Google, Rafailov quantum.lasers or quantum.lasers of Rafailov, maybe you will find some references. New references.
Professor, thank you very much for your very interesting talk. I have a question. So along your presentation, you mentioned about cadmium selenide, telluride, zinc selenide. So, why there is like less, or maybe you can tell a little bit about this, about nitride materials. So, what is the perspective of nitride materials like gallium nitride, indium nitride?
Oh, okay, okay.
For colloidal. Yeah, for
nano-optoelectronics. There was big activity in the 90s by Asur Nozick and Olga Mitic. They make, I feel they made some nitride nanoparticles, but at the moment I do not know why. At that time nobody knows that there will be another price for lead. Do that will make lightning revolution. You see, maybe this is the reason. Maybe there are some chemical issues. So people were looking for originally infrared material, which upon refinement will shine in the visible. Most of the people went around this. You see. And people were looking for optical modulators that look about optical communication wavelength and lasers. If you take the table of available commercial available solid state lasers, there is no less in the visible. No. Rabi laser is still the only one. The Rabi laser is still the only commercial laser for the visible solid state laser. There are semiconductor lasers for the visible, and there are dye laser, obsolete dye laser, and there is very popular titanium sapphire laser which generates near infrared and up to 660, 670. Then if you double, you can go, if you double like 780, you can go to 380. But there is no tunable solid state lasers available in the market. So you see, so people think about to fit something in the visible, you see, and if for quantum dot laser modulators, people think about existing solid state lasers. So they go to infrared, basically, to infrared, you see. But I'm not ready. This question is challenging, I say, to me. Either there are some chemical related to 3.5 or just by chance. I don't know. At that time, by the way, at that time, everybody wanted to make thin selenide diet. I was a PhD student in a laboratory where most of the people were dealing with thin telluride and thin selenide in the 80s. There were special conferences about optical properties of the 60s. As Yusin Nakamura highlighted in his Nobel lecture, he understands that he failed two times to compete with big companies because he followed the general trend in his research. And he understands that back in a small company, he cannot compete with big companies. So he decided to try that. Maybe if I would do something what big company missed, maybe if I succeed, then I will be the pioneer. And his supervisor in the company, the president, allowed him. This is his just for Nobel lecture. And he started with 3.5. But for 3.5, I would say, I mentioned quantum wells, but still some room for discussion. There is an opinion that nobody understands why you see this value of nitride, value of indium nitride based on the structure is so insensitive to existing defects. And the reasonable answer is that they are mining not quantum well emitted light, but quantum loop. There is even, you see, proofs that indium is not soluble in gallium nitride. And when people put indium, supposing they will get solid solution, instead they will have clusters. These clusters evolve to quantum dots. And then quantum dots is insensitive to dislocation or to strains. And even Nakamura says, until now I do not understand why this material grown on, you see, under big misfit of lattice on sapphire is so efficient and so stable. This is a little citation.
In the interest of time, we should thank our speaker.
Did you give the papers to Adam?
Why?
Did you check the email? I guess you should. So she comes with it. Because you should attend finals. Okay, and you tell her that you attended. Okay, you need to like attend 5 minutes.
Yes.
You finish the report.
No,
I don't usually sign, but I just tell her that we just signed. Okay, don't usually sign, I just tell her that I attended that school. So it's not a problem.
Is that okay?
Yeah. Like I've never signed before, and so this is my fourth one. Yeah, it's not necessary. Like this is my fourth one, and they just stayed right on them, so, but before I just go to it.